Hi, I'm Tim Berglund with Confluent. Today, I'd like to talk to you about Apache Iceberg. Iceberg is an open table format. What is an open table format? Why do they exist? How does Iceberg work? I'd like to start, as always, with a little bit of history. Let's go back about 35, maybe 40 years to the data warehouse. Data warehouse was a big database that contained the data from a bunch of, well, smaller databases, right? These were the operational, usually relational databases out in the enterprise, and we'd collect their data overnight through a process called ETL, extract, transform, and load, and load it into the data warehouse, which was then available for reports, analysis, querying the next day. This was a batch process. There's, you know, a whole overnight kind of thing. And it might seem old-fashioned these days, but this was great technology in its day. It lasted until it didn't. Eventually started to give way for reasons of scale and other things to another thing, maybe about 15 or so years ago, called the data lake. Now, it wasn't called the data lake right away. It was called Hadoop at first, really. But this was, we'll say, a big distributed file system where we would still have these operational databases out in the world. Those have never gone anywhere, right? They still have all these data sources and maybe now mobile devices and sort of early streaming data sources and all these things coming into this data lake. And instead of all of this attention to the schema of the inputs and the specialized, specially designed schema in the data warehouse, and this extract transform load, we just kind of extract the data, load it into the data lake, and transform it later. So there was this extract, load, transform. And this was supposed to be a revolutionary change to get all the data into this data lake. Again, initially, this took the form of Hadoop. These days, the data lake, as a going concern now, is often cloud blob stores, say S3. So this is a little bit anachronistic for the beginning, but these days, these are just S3 buckets. All the data from out there, bringing it into here, and one of the main transitions, apart from scale, trying to make a system that can scale to larger volumes of data, is less attention to schema. So there was this idea that maybe somehow schema was a bad idea. We didn't want to spend so much effort on that, which is completely understandable for the thinkers and builders of the time because schema is a tremendous pain, right? So we can kind of understand how they got there. However, over time, schema does kind of matter. You still do want to know the format of the data in here. We still want to think of data as tabular. We want to run SQL queries over data. So, you know, we kind of do need some kind of system that gives us access to schema. Iceberg, in particular, an open source project that emerged from Netflix, they also had a concern with consistency. So, this being essentially a large distributed file system, I could have little bits of tables and different files all over. If I'm going to modify something, it's difficult without some kind of layer to wrap it to have a consistent view of the data in there. And we would also love transactionality. That would be nice too. There are other benefits, but kind of broadly speaking, in this data warehouse to data lake transition, some of these things got lost and that was difficult. And so Iceberg and others like it emerged. That's the history. I want to give you an idea how it works, and I'm going to kind of start bottom up and build things a piece at a time into sort of a logical architecture of Iceberg and give you an example of how this gets applied in the modern streaming world. So let's just say we're going to start with some data files. And these data files here, I'll just go down here, make this little document here, right? There's a file. Here's another file, got some stuff on it. We'll say these are Parquet files. That is certainly standard. That's a non-controversial choice. Typically the file format you're going to find in any kind of data lake. So let's just start with that. We've got Parquet files. Let's just say I've got some, we'll make it easy, batch ingest process. I got a bunch of stuff. I need to get it into my data lake. I could just split that up into Parquet files, put them in some directory, and say, okay, there's my table. Well, that is kind of like the early version of what a data lake was. I'm not gonna have any schema management. I'm not gonna be able to do consistent updates. Certainly I don't have transactionality. So that's not quite enough. Let's build some layers on top of this, all right? And I'm gonna draw a dividing line here. So this is my data layer, and up here, this is gonna be my metadata layer. To begin with, I'd just like to have some record of which files I've got here. All right, so I'm gonna make a manifest file. And that manifest file is just gonna say, hey, look, these two Parquet files, that's your table. If I'm smart and I wanna be able to optimize queries, there's other things I might be able to add into that manifest file, not just a list of paths of Parquet files, but these Parquet files, that's a columnar data file. There is sort of typing and metadata built in there. I've got columns. Those columns have data types. If they're numbers, I might be able to track things like the max or the min value and other interesting things about this data that might help me process queries later on. So this isn't just a list of files. There's a little bit more smarts to it than that here. But now that I've got some collection of files, I say, well, I would like a manifest file to describe this ingest that I've done in this current version of this table. Life goes on though, and I do some more ingesting, right? So let's say, I write a few more Parquet files down here, and that's also, you know, I really would like them to be considered to be a part of the same table. So I'm gonna have to make, another manifest to indicate that those are there. But now that I've added the ability to ingest more than once, which is pretty important, particularly in case of streaming systems that involve Kafka, I might be doing ingest kind of constantly, right? So I need to be able to ingest often. I've got multiple manifest files, so I'm going to need another layer on top of this. We'll call this the manifest list. So now I've got a way to collect multiple ingest events or multiple manifest files into one collection. And now I can say, all right, I got this manifest list. Now this represents the table. If I want a description of what the table is, go to this thing, and that tells me where all my data is, tells me a little bit about it, maybe something about the schema. I can kind of pack all that stuff in here. And this is pretty cool so far. This is like a sane way to manage tables, but What about consistency? What about transactionality? What about when I say want to change the schema? Now, as I like to say, there's nothing that makes schema migration really pleasant, but we would like tooling that makes it at least possible. And so far here, if I was going to change schema, I would be modifying manifest files, maybe building out new Parquet, new data files, something. There'd be a lot of things going on, and this table would be in an inconsistent state for potentially a long time before that change were complete. I wouldn't like that. So maybe let's come up with a way of snapshotting, and this will be our actual metadata file. This will eventually point to the manifest list, but I'm gonna skip a little bit. I'm gonna say, this is gonna have a notion of a snapshot. So this is snap zero right here, and that snapshot points to an actual manifest list, which points to actual manifest files, which points to actual Parquet files. And now, by the way, as I've built pieces here, I said before, this was what our table is. Now I'm saying, okay, the metadata file, this is what really describes a table. It points to a manifest list, which points to manifest files, which point to data files, and it contains these snapshots. So I can make snapshot one, I can make snapshot two. It can contain multiple snapshots, which, let's see, this might point to another manifest list, which might have another manifest file, which might point to this Parquet file, and potentially even a new one down here, and maybe even parts of this new snapshot are our old data that was already in that table, since we're potentially adding on to this table or keeping old parts of the table as we move forward in snapshots. So with this metadata file component, now finally I've got some way of seeing consistent views of the data, even as the data is changing and as the schema is changing. And that's pretty cool. And that's all built essentially with Parquet files and little pieces of JSON scattered in a bucket in S3. Just this structure, you've got a lot of this functionality. One more component we'll put on top of that, we'll just call this the catalog, which in summary is going to tell me, you know, my table, say the table is named thermostats or something like that. Well, okay, that thermostat table name, that's this metadata file, and that tells us where to go from there. So it's my way of looking things up in my Iceberg data. So that's the basics in terms of logical architecture of Apache Iceberg. And in terms of physical infrastructure, when I'm trying to learn a new system, I always like to know, like, okay, what is it? You know, what are the pieces it's made out of? The logical structure matters, but these are files. I mentioned S3 or blob store like it. This seems to be a database of some kind, but is that what Iceberg is? Is Iceberg like a server process? Do I go run it somewhere? Can I go buy it at iceberg.tech or, you know, I don't know, wherever it is? The answer is no. It really is a specification, and all of these things are very pluggable. Like this catalog can be the Hive Metastore. It could be a JDBC database. It could be SQLite running on Raspberry Pi if you're into that kind of thing. So it's just a database that is keeping track of the rest of where the metadata files exist. In the world of streaming, Iceberg now lets us store our data in a data lake, have very much, you know, relational database-like semantics around that data, even though it is really Parquet files in a database, and gives us flexibility into how we're going to query that now. There isn't a server. There isn't some like main way in. There's a set of libraries that you can use. You can write Java code, Python code, Flink code, Spark, whatever, you know. Then there's other tools like Presto that'll even let you do sophisticated joins across tables in here. There's all kinds of tools on top of Iceberg that obey this open standard that let you do the kinds of querying that you want. And it opens things up in the world of streaming that are really exciting. So a thing that we at Confluent do with this is we realize that, you know, most of the time, what feeds the data lake? Oh, it might be a batch process, right? But, you know, these days I think we know it's probably a Kafka topic or more than one Kafka topic that's feeding that data lake, or writing to those Parquet files. And why have this before and after thing where I've got this streaming world over here and I'm going to do some minimal stream processing, dump it into the data lake, and then Iceberg is happening over here? Why not just, you know, with an option, enable Iceberg semantics on top of that data? And that is what Confluent calls TableFlow, which is a way of making the data in a topic accessible as an Iceberg table. So changes to that topic, changes to the schema through the schema registry and the governance features of Confluent Cloud, keep all of the appropriate manifest files, lists, and metadata files updated. So however it is you are accessing Iceberg, you point it at your Kafka topic, and that works without the old copy from there to here kind of thing, which is kind of cool. A lot of neat things are happening. Obviously, there's so much more to say about Iceberg, how it deals with updates and upserts and deletes, and how it pulls off transactions in terms of you know, the steps it goes through. So much to say, so much more to learn. I hope this gives you a good overview of the reasons, the logical architecture, and the modern implications of an important technology like Iceberg. Thanks.